What's going on, all my healthcare professionals? I hope that you are having a wonderful day. Today, we're going to be continuing on with our cardiovascular and electrocardiogram Like a Boss series, and we're going to be discussing cardiac pacemakers and the electrical pathway. So today, we're going to begin talking about our cardiac pacemakers. They are certain cells within our conduction pathway that allow our heart to function. So we have normal pacemakers, backup pacemakers, as well as competing pacemakers. So let's break them down a little bit further. Our normal pacemakers, such as our SA node, is the dominant center of automaticity. So the SA node allows the heart to fire 60 to 100 beats per minute. That's usually where we see our normal sinus rhythms. Backup pacemakers are as our AV node. Our AV junction will respond when our normal pacemaker, our SA node, fails to function. So you're gonna see on our AV nodes allowing our heart to pump 40 to 60 beats per minute. And these are gonna be primarily our junctional rhythms. Our competing pacemakers is a ventricular focus on the Purkinje fibers, which will initiate an impulse when the SA node and the AV node fails to do so. So that ventricular rate is gonna be very slow. Our Purkinje fibers are gonna allow the heart to fire 20 to 40 beats per minute. And with these very, very slow rates, you're going to see those idioventricular rhythms. So something that the heart does well is overdrive suppression. So what is that? It is an important characteristic of the conduction pathway system. There can only be one primary pacemaker at a time. So the overdrive suppression is a mechanism where the pacemaker with the greatest nodal firing, like our SA node, it's got our greatest firing, has the ability to dominate over those other slower pacemakers. So this allows the heart to pump as an organized unit driven by that single pacemaker. So for example, the SA node, our faster node, that's our sinus rhythms, that's our 60 to 100 beats per minute, will overdrive suppress the AV node and competing pacemakers with a slower rate. If the SA node ceases to function, a slower node, such as our AV node, will emerge and pace the heart at its inherent rate. So let's take a closer look at our conduction pathway. The conduction pathway is the route of electrical impulses through the heart. Our normal conduction pathway is our SA node, our intranodal pathway, our AV node, we move on to the bundle of His, the right and left bundle branches into the Purkinje fiber. So let's break down what each one of these are. So in the SA node, our sinoatrial node, it's the electrical impulse of a normal heart begins in the upper right atrium, spreading out, causing the atria to contract. We move on to our intranodal pathways. So the atria contains specialized fiber, which helps guide each impulse to reach that atrioventricular or AV node. That AV node acts like a radio tower that signals the two main receivers, that is our right and our left ventricles. It is normal that the AV node will cause a critical delay in the conduction pathway at the AV node. This allows the blood to flow effectively from the atria to the ventricle. Without this delay, the atria and ventricles would contract at the same time. That's not good. We don't want that. Next, we go on to the bundle of His. A rapid signal conduction pathway passes from the AV node through the bundle of His and then through two separate pathways called the right and left bundle branches. Our left bundle branch separates into smaller branches which supply the left ventricle, and our right bundle branch conducts signals to our right ventricle. Lastly, we have those good old passionate Purkinje fibers at the bottom. Their transmission reaches the Purkinje fibers, sending the signal into the ventricles, causing contraction and forcing blood out of the heart, either into the lungs or into our body. So now that we understand what that conduction pathway looks like, we need to understand what that looks like with our ECG waveform. So we're going to begin with our isoelectric line. This depicts the resting phase of the myocardium and is the baseline tracing without electrical activity. Waveforms and intervals are measured at the point of deviation from this isoelectric line. So we begin with our P wave. It represents electrical depolarization of our atria. Normal P waves do not exceed 2.5 millimeters in amplitude and are usually less than 0.12 seconds wide. Our Q wave, seen here in the green, is the first portion of the QRS complex in the downward negative deflection. It is indicative of the beginning of ventricular depolarization, and sometimes Q waves can be absent, and the first deflection that you will see will be positive. R waves are our first upright or positive deflection of the QRS complex after the P wave and represents ventricular depolarization. After our R wave, we have our S wave. It is the downward or negative deflection that follows an R wave and denotes the completion of ventricular depolarization. Then we have our good old T wave. Our T wave represents ventricular repolarization immediately following the QRS. Normal T waves will deflect the same direction as the QRS. And lastly, you may see a U wave. A U wave is the final phase of the ventricular repolarization. Sometimes it's seen as a small deflection immediately after the T wave. Now that we've seen the basic breakdown of our electrocardiogram waveform, we're going to break it down a little bit further. We're going to begin with our PR interval. The interval is measured from the beginning of the P wave to the onset of the QRS complex. A normal PR interval ranges between 0.12 seconds to 0.2 seconds. The length of the PR interval signifies the measurement of time of the electrical impulse traveling from the atria to the ventricle. Next, we have our QRS complex. The QRS is measured from the start of the Q wave or from the beginning of the R wave to the end of the S wave. A normal QRS interval should be less than 0.12 seconds, even if no Q wave is present. The length of the QRS interval signifies the measured time of the electrical impulse traveling through the ventricles. Another interval that you're going to be required to measure is our QT interval. So the interval reflects both ventricular depolarization and repolarization. A normal QT interval is measured approximately 0.44 seconds. The length of the QT interval signifies the time measured from the beginning of the QRS complex to the end of the T wave. And lastly, we have our ST segment, that little puppy that can cause a lot of problems, especially with our myocardial infarction patients. So this interval represents a portion of ventricular repolarization. A normal ST segment is usually flat or isoelectric. It is measured at the end of the QRS to the beginning of the T wave. I hope that this video was helpful in elevating your cardiac knowledge and helping you pass those exams like a boss. Make sure that you check out my website at www.nursecheung.com where you can get copies of these resources, the PowerPoints, as well as test questions that I will be including with each one of these videos within the series. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them down below. I love answering your questions, and make sure you follow me on my social media. I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, as well as here on YouTube. Make sure you subscribe and make sure you turn on that notification bell. Until next time, I hope that you're having a wonderful day, and I can't wait to see you all again soon. Bye.